So I'm excited today to get to introduce Matt Hewitt from Sol Ross University. His presentation is Kit Fox Occupancy and Co-occurrence with Coyotes in the Trans-Pecos of Texas. Matt grew up in Southern Texas, where he developed a passion for hunting, fishing, and the outdoors, and realized from a young age that he would spend his life working with wildlife. He earned his bachelor's degree in range and wildlife management from his hometown university, Texas A&M University in Kingsville, in the spring of 2017. From there, he accepted a master's position at Sol Ross State University, where he modeled the potential distribution of kit fox and their relationship with coyotes in the Trans-Pecos through the Borderlands Research Institute in Alpine, Texas. He graduated with a master's degree in the spring of 2020 and has since started a job with the research branch of the Oregon Department of Fisheries and Wildlife, where he is enjoying working with a wide variety of wildlife on the Coast Range. So thank you, Matt, for sharing your presentation with us. And I will now pass over controls to you so that you can start sharing your screen.
Fantastic. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Hopefully everybody can hear me. And I will start sharing.
Perfect. I can see your screen now. Okay. I can hear you. Okay. I don't see video, but that's fine. Okay. Either way. So
yeah, we'll leave the video off for this one, I think.
Okay, that works. All right. Thanks, all right. Everybody.
Yeah. So yeah, thank you for logging on and listening to me talk about something I am very passionate about. Like Jonah said, this is the research that I did for my master's that I did out of Sol Ross State University with Borderlands Research Institute in Alpine, Texas. So a little bit of an outline of what I'm going to be talking about today. I'm going to introduce what a kit fox is, because I certainly know that I did not know what a kit fox was when I came into this program. Introduce just a little bit about them, where they are, and then I'll move into our data collection methods and image processing methods. And since both of my the chapters I'm going to be presenting on today both use the same data, I figured to just go over that once here in the beginning instead of once for each chapter. So once we cover that, we can get into looking at the potential distribution of kit fox in Texas, and from there, how coyotes are potentially interacting with kit fox in this region. To start out, a kit fox is a small desert obligate mesocarnivore that occupies the deserts of the American Southwest, as well as portions of Mexico. And since they are such a desert adapted species, they are primarily nocturnal, actually almost exclusively nocturnal, and utilize dens during the day, subterranean dens, for heat avoidance. And their diet is said to be the most abundant rodent or lagomorph within the vicinity of their den. And very commonly is cottontail rabbits, jackrabbits, you know, and I suppose any other wide variety of rodents, but it does seem very common that a particular favorite are these kangaroo rats, which is what is pictured here on the slide. And just for a little bit of a size reference on just how small these guys are, that wooden stake in the photo is 16 inches tall. So this guy at the shoulder might be about 12 inches or so. And yeah, here is a distribution map of them across the entirety of the region. So as you can see, they range from southern Oregon down into central Mexico, including this Trans-Pecos region of Texas. But yeah, kit fox are declining. Many states that kit fox occupy have reported a decline in species distribution within that state. And with really no information on kit fox in the Trans-Pecos, you know, no prior information really before this study, you know, we don't really know how kit fox are doing in the state. You know, we don't know if their population is, you know, perhaps declining like other portions of its range, or if they're doing just fine. The Texas Parks and Wildlife has been working with schools in the Texas Panhandle looking at swift fox distribution and have noticed a pretty dramatic decline in their distribution in that part of the state. So that kind of shifted the focus a little bit to kit fox in the Trans-Pecos and kind of wondering how they're doing. So that's what kit fox is, and that's why we're kind of doing this project. So now I can jump into how we were going to model some of this stuff. So as you can imagine, the Trans-Pecos region of Texas is a pretty large land mass, over 81,000 square kilometers, and would logistically pretty much be impossible to survey the entirety of it. So we decided to kind of narrow down our survey efforts to areas that we thought we would have the most likelihood of detecting a kit fox. So we kind of dove into the literature and determined that areas of grassland with less than 5% slopes were the areas that we were going to survey. So we used GIS data from Texas Parks and Wildlife, as well as some digital elevation models downloaded from TenRIS to kind of identify these areas. And that's what's happening in this map down here. Those light green areas throughout the region are those areas of grassland with less than 5% slopes. So once we identified that area, you know, the area that we wanted to survey, we contacted cooperating landowners within that area of interest, so ranches within that habitat of grassland with less than 5% slopes, and started deploying cameras. Our cameras were spaced on a 3-kilometer grid to assure spatial independence of detections based on kit fox home range size from other portions of their range. And each of our bait sites was baited. We have a can of cat food there, as you can tell in our little diagram, as well as a scent tablet that helps, you know, attract kit fox to these locations so we can get a detection of them. Surveys lasted for 2 weeks per ranch or per property, and surveys lasted from March 2018 through March 2020, so a 2-year survey period. So at the end of this 2-week sampling period on each ranch, I would go back out, collect all materials, and bring the photos back to the school for, you know, kind of some processing. We would use a lot of functions from this R package, Camtrap R, that allowed us to very quickly rename photos based on their location, as well as the time that they were taken, as well as kind of some of our cameras. These trail cameras had a problem with jumping around, like with the date and time, not keeping a consistent date and time throughout the 2-week survey. So this Camtrap R package has some functions that can kind of help us compensate for that. So yeah, we used these functions to set up this file database and store all the photos in a orderly fashion. And then the next step after that, we were partnering with Microsoft, helping them or providing photos for them to train some image recognition models. And what these image recognition models did was tell us whether or not there was an animal in a photo, which for the mass amounts of photos that we got from this project was instrumental. I'm not sure we would have been able to do this any other way. So these image recognition outputs or data sets that we got from Microsoft, we would use with this other program, Timelapse 2, which is what we're showing in that middle little photo down there at the bottom of the coyote with the box around him. And what this Timelapse 2 allowed us to do is very quickly and systematically, you know, view only photos that had animals in them and identify those photos down to species and start creating our, some of our detection histories and stuff. Here's some basic summary stats from our surveys. We had 732 camera locations spread across the Trans-Pecos. On 48 individual ranches, a little over 10,000 trap days, and 3.3 million photos, only about 4% of which actually contained animals. So, you know, as I was saying before, that image recognition stuff was really a game changer. And we had 313 one-hour independent photos of kit fox at 99 cameras, and we detected a total of 42 species. It's just a pretty basic detection map showing you where we got our detections. the number within each county represents the number of cameras within that county that got a kit fox detection, and the color gradient of the counties represents the percent of cameras within that county that got a kit fox detection. And this color gradient is to give you a little bit of an idea of survey effort given per county. And yeah, as you can kind of tell, the further north and west you go within the region, the more detections that we got. So that's our data, how we collected and how we organized it. So now we can jump into how we use this data to determine potential kit fox distribution. So why are we doing this? Why is this important? Like I mentioned before, kit fox are known to be declining throughout a majority of their range. Their distribution is known to be declining or constricting. Without any prior information of the species really in Texas, we have no idea, you know, how they are doing here. So the results from this chapter or from this analysis will kind of give us some baseline information to possibly compare to in the future to help us, you know, identify which direction this population trend is going. And to do this, we use occupancy analysis, which works very well with our camera trap detection, non-detection data, and also allows us to use different environmental and temporal covariates to help us predict species occupancy and detection, as well as can kind of compensate for false negative detections, which is something that's fairly common with camera traps. So just because a camera did not detect a kit fox within, you know, our 2-week sampling period does not mean that a kit fox did not actually occupy that area. So this occupancy analysis is able to use these environmental and temporal covariates to kind of compensate for that, for those false negatives or the possibility of false negatives. Some of the parameters that we used for this occupancy analysis, each camera was considered its own survey unit, meaning that we did not have a paired camera survey or a clustered camera survey design. Each camera was its own independent survey. Surveys lasted, you know, like I said in one of the previous slides, an average of 14 days, some were slightly over, some were slightly less. And we decided to use a 3-day occasion length. And to kind of explain what an occasion is, we have this little visual display down here with the top row being occasions 1 through 5. The second row being number of days. So in this particular scenario, it was a 15-day survey. And the third row being our detection history. And to explain what this means, the detection history having a 1 implies that we did detect a kit fox at any time in occasion 1. So anytime within the beginning of day 3 or beginning of day 1 to the end of day 3. And if the detection history has a 0, that means a kit fox was not detected at any point during that 3-day period, as in, you know, our second occasion here, beginning of day 4 to end of day 6, we did not detect a kit fox at this theoretical camera site. And yeah, so here are some of the covariates that we decided to test to help us predict kit fox occupancy and detection. For species occupancy, we tested elevation, slope, shrub height, percent shrub cover, bare ground, and percent litter. Each of these things we hypothesized to have an actual effect on kit fox occupancy. And we also tested one temporal covariate on species detection, which is the number of occasions past survey setup. So yeah, the amount of time past deployment of that survey site. And we kind of theorized that this could be significant, you know, due to the bait decomposing over time and either losing potency or perhaps gaining potency, or, you know, perhaps just the novelty of the survey site on the landscape, you know, kind of wearing off over time. So here are the top 4 models from our model selection process. So we tested every combination of covariates that were not correlated to one another. And these are the top four models. And as you can tell, that first ranked model, its weight is 83, percent of this candidate set. So we're very confident in this being our top model here. And as you can see under the occupancy side of the model on the left side, for our top ranked model, percent slope, elevation, shrub height, and bare ground were each identified as significant predictors of kit fox occupancy, while our one temporal covariate, that number of occasions past survey setup, also was considered important for species detection. And like we kind of theorized, this temporal covariate had a negative relationship with species detection. So the earlier in the survey, that we are, the more likely we were to detect a kit fox. Just kind of looking at this graph real quick. At the beginning of occasion one, we had a 50% chance of detecting a kit fox, given that it was present. And by the end of the fifth occasion, we had a roundabout 25% chance of detecting a kit fox, given that it was present on the landscape. And averagely, anyway, up here at the top, we had a 35% chance or a probability of detection across all of our survey sites. And here are each of the environmental covariates that were deemed important for predicting kit fox occupancy. Kit fox were very slightly negatively associated with elevation, preferring lower elevations. They were very strongly negatively associated with percent slope and shrub height, again, preferring lower slopes and shorter shrubs, and were pretty strongly positively correlated with percent bare ground, preferring more bare ground. And again, we had a 16% chance or a probability of occupancy of kit fox across all of our survey sites. So yeah, looking at this, we kind of identify habitats that are very flat with open grounds, lots of bare ground with shorter shrubs, which is very consistent with other habitat studies conducted on kit fox throughout their range. And using this top model, some of the results from this top model, we were able to create this potential distribution map for the species in the Trans-Pecos, with areas of red and orange being areas of higher predicted occupancy, and areas of darkening green being areas of lower predicted occupancy. And fairly unsurprisingly, this El Paso, Hudspeth in the top left, those counties, and then Reeves and Pecos County, that the circle on the right, is very unsurprising that we had levels of high predicted occupancy here, or areas of high predicted occupancy. If you remember back to our detections map before, I said, the further north and west we went, the more detections we got. So this makes a lot of sense and really, flows with our detections. But fairly surprisingly, the southern end of Brewster County down here, down in the Big Bend National Park area, also has areas of very high predicted occupancy. And we did not have a whole lot of surveys in this area because it did not come out in our grasslands with less than 5% slopes layer. So it wasn't really an area that we focused surveys in. And this is because this area is a lot more brushy than other areas that we, we're prioritizing surveys for. But according to park staff and other Texas Parks and Wildlife biologists, kit fox do occupy this area. So it could be a place to focus survey efforts a little bit more heavily in the future. So that's potential distribution. And now we can jump into how coyotes might kind of fit into this picture a little bit. So Why are we doing this? Why is it important to look at coyotes? Coyotes have been identified as one of the largest sources of predation-related mortality for kit fox across their range, and have even been theorized as being a population-limiting factor in certain areas. So understanding how coyotes and kit fox interact on the landscape can really help us understand why kit fox might be using certain habitats, using the land the way that they are, as well as just understanding, how coyotes could be affecting kit fox spatially. And to do this, we used a conditional two species occupancy model that uses parameters of a predetermined dominant species, in our case, coyotes, to help predict or to help tease out any effect, if any, this dominant species would have on a predetermined subordinate species. In our case, that would be the kit fox. And it also can take into consideration these environmental and temporal covariates, as well as these behavioral parameters. So it can test each of these different states here. I know this is kind of a lot to look at. But it can test each of these states to see which of these best fits our data. And to kind of walk you through this a little bit and what all this means, this first row up here with a picture of the coyote and the kit fox in the same parentheses is kind of our null model. If this turns out to be our top model, that implies that coyotes and kit fox probability of detection does not differ. It is the same. Coming down one row, that would imply that the probability of detection for coyotes and kit fox are different, but do not depend on one another. So they are independent of one another. Coming down another row, coyotes probability of detection is still independent, but kit fox probability of detection is dependent on whether coyotes occupy that site or not. Coming down another row, same thing with kit fox. But now coyotes are also, probability of detection for coyotes is also dependent upon kit fox occupancy. And then this last row down here on the bottom, same story for coyotes, but kit fox probability of detection is now dependent upon coyote occupancy, as well as whether that coyote that was present was detected or not. So yeah, that was detection, and here are the different behavioral states that we can predict for occupancy. Again, this top row is kind of our null model with there not being any difference between the two species. The second row here, again, being or having a separate probability of occupancy for each species, but being independent of one another. And then this last row, coyotes being independent, but kit fox probability of occupancy being dependent upon coyote occupancy. So as you can imagine, with all these different behavioral and environmental covariates, candidate model sets can become very, very large. So we decided to employ this three-step model selection process to kind of cut down on this. Step one was to use environmental and temporal covariates deemed to be important for kit fox. So we're gonna pull kind of some of the results from our single species occupancy analysis and use them in these models. And our second step was to determine which of the behavioral states best fit detection while holding the occupancy side constant. And then once we determined that, we would hold detection constant and determine which of the occupancy states best described our data. So looking at the results from that, what I have circled here is the detection state that best described our data. So to jump back to this slide real quick, it is this third state here where probability of detections of coyotes is independent of kit fox, but the probability of detection of kit fox is dependent upon coyotes occupying that site. And just to throw it out there, this the trend was a positive one. So the probability of detection of kit fox went up at sites where coyotes also occupied. And yeah, so this is the what is circled now is the occupancy side of this model. And as you can see, we still have elevation, percent slope, shrub, and bare ground in this model. So those were still significant predictors in this model. And this is the occupancy state that best describes our data. So coyotes are, the probability of occupancy for coyotes is independent of kit fox, but the probability of occupancy for kit fox is dependent upon coyote occupancy. And again, the trend on this is the same way. We were more, or a site was more likely to be occupied by a kit fox if that site was also occupied by a coyote. And here's the effect plots for the co-occurrence analysis. And the effects on kit fox really have not changed. Still negatively associated with elevation, slope, and shrub height, positively associated with bare ground. But now we can also see how each of these things affected coyotes. So yeah, coyotes were positively associated with elevation and bare ground, while being negatively associated with slope and shrub height. So some slight habitat differences there, or yeah, habitat use there. Oh, and yeah, both species are still negatively associated with that that temporal covariate on detection. You know, with both species being more likely to be detected at the beginning of a survey session versus at the end. And this is a activity pattern overlap plot showing when each species was most active during the day. So the black line represents kit fox, and you know, the higher it is, the more active they were at that time. And the red dotted line being for coyotes. And the shaded area, you know, kind of on the bottom left and bottom right of this plot, represents times when both species were active. So as you can tell, both species were very well, kit fox were exclusively nocturnal and spent no time active during the day, where coyotes were definitely mostly active nocturnally, but did exhibit some diurnal activity. So to kind of interpret this in a real world way, we really don't have the evidence to support our hypothesis that coyotes are kind of displacing kit fox out of certain habitats. According to the results from this, they really are co-occurring pretty successfully. excuse me, co-occurring successfully on the landscape. And you know, looking at that, looking at this slide here, you know, this co-occurrence likely is not facilitated through a temporal avoidance. As you can see, both species are very active at night. You know, it's not like one species is active at night and the other is active during the day. You know, they're both active during the same times. So what we're thinking is there is some habitat separation on a scale that was too fine for us to detect with the spatial scale that we surveyed. So I, you know, perhaps they are using habitat differently, but we just weren't able to detect that with how we conducted this analysis. So with that, yeah, I've got a lot of people to thank. Texas Parks and Wildlife, absolutely, for all the help of the county biologists with property contacting and of course project funding. All of my committee members, Dr. Patricia Moody Harbison, Dr. Dana Corellis, Dr. Lewis Harbison, and all my project technicians for quite literally looking through millions and millions of photos. The Potts and Sibley Foundation, fellow grad students, and of course participating landowners. Without landowners, this would not have been possible. And with that, I would love to take some questions.
Matt, thank you so much for that presentation. Really cool stuff. I'd like to remind everybody that there should be a Q&A box in the lower right-hand side of your screen. And if you have any questions, feel free to put them in there. I have not seen any so far, so I'm going to ask somebody that's on the call to just say hi in the Q&A box to help me make sure that it is indeed working. If it's not, I can change my settings and make sure that the, oh, hey, someone said hi. Fantastic. So I'll give another minute to see if anyone has any questions for the presentation. Otherwise, I thought it was really, really cool. Okay, we have a question from Mari. Is coyote diet same as foxes?
So I think there would be a lot of overlap between them. But just from reading a lot of the papers that I read for this project, it seemed like coyotes would kind of focus more on larger prey items, like possibly more jackrabbits and even up to baby deer and pronghorn and stuff like that, where kit fox were a little bit more focused on rodents and possibly small birds and stuff like that. So I think there would be a lot of overlap, but not identical.
And Ronald Childers asked, what was the highest number of foxes seen in a photo?
So I think we had two foxes in one photo was the highest we ever got.
And Meredith Longoria said, very interesting project, wonderful collection of photos too. Jennifer Moore said, do you think using a lure affected your estimates of occupancy?
I think it definitely could have, yes. We were pretty concerned about not getting enough detections, with this species, being as wily as they are. We decided to use a scent lure just to ensure that we got enough detections, to be able to actually do the analysis.
And were you consistent about using the scent lure from throughout the project, or did your use of it vary?
No, it was very uniform across the entirety of the project.
Yeah. So, I mean, in my assessment, I don't really see any issue with that that would cause some sort of bias. I mean, you're wondering if they're there and your trap has a certain amount of detection probability, and as long as that's consistent.
Correct, yeah.
I think you should be fine. Do kit foxes work a route over their territory?
There were a few like movement papers that I looked at. Again, that wasn't one of the things we looked at for this project, but speaking from other people's projects, it seemed like that they would kind of make pretty good movements nocturnally, whether for that was hunting or what. I couldn't really tell you, but it does seem that they kind of patrol their territory.
And are either preyed upon by cougars? And I guess by either they mean kit foxes and coyotes.
Okay, I wouldn't say it's impossible. I don't think that either of them would be a preferred prey item for cougars, but and especially not kit fox, just because of the habitats that kit fox live in. I would imagine that wouldn't be a place where you would find a lot of cougars. So I would say the probability would be pretty small.
And Jessica Buskirk asked, she said, thank you for sharing. I really enjoyed hearing about it. Since you only surveyed a small specific portion of the landscape, do you think there might be a bias or limitation in your distribution map? I wonder if there might be limitations to apply the model to land cover types you didn't survey.
Yeah, no, you were very correct. Because we decided to only survey areas of grassland with less than 5% slopes, it would be a little bit of an extrapolation, I think, to apply these results to habitats outside of that. But not to say it's inaccurate, but that is something that we are trying to take into consideration. Yeah.
And then, did you detect gray foxes and bobcats? Question from George Oliver.
Absolutely. Yep. Lots of gray foxes, lots of bobcats.
And the last question we have right now is from Casey Cowan, or Cohen, if I apologize if I mispronounce your name. It's, did the Microsoft relationship end with a public software for other researchers? Is there something out there for public? I am doing camera trap surveys on new land bridge in San Antonio. I'm gonna guess that's San Antonio, not South Africa. And I feel like this would be very helpful.
They do have some publicly available models. It's not like a downloadable program that's super easy to use. Like you do have to have some knowledge in Python, the programming language. But it is all technically available. And I think if you just Google Microsoft camera traps, it has a pretty good website that it can kind of walk you through setting it up. And making these image recognition image recognition outputs. So yeah, absolutely. Please look into it. It is a very useful tool.
I'd like to just elaborate on that briefly. Was it you found it to be easy to use and saved a huge amount of time and pretty accurate? I'm curious to hear you just elaborate a little bit on your use of that.
So ease of use. Like I said, we sent all our photos to Microsoft and they just sent back those image recognition data sets. So we weren't the ones actually running the models. So for ease of use for us, yeah, it was pretty good. But in the job that I'm in now, I have downloaded some of these models and have been running it, locally on some of the computers here at work. And it's not the most user-friendly thing in the world, but if you know something about Python coding and how this stuff works, they definitely have enough information on websites or on their website to walk you through it. And as far as accuracy goes, yeah, I think it was pretty accurate. It gives a confidence rating for each of its whether it thinks there's an animal in a photo. So a 0% confident to a 99% confident. And we would kind of go down that confidence until we realized that we stopped seeing animals, and that was kind of our cutoff line. For us, that was 70%. So I don't think there was ever a photo under 70% confident of containing an animal that did not have an animal, or that did have an animal, I'm sorry. So yeah, I think it was fairly accurate, and we were very impressed with it.
So we have another question here from Jay McDarby. The question is regarding your model. And he said, if I understand correctly, you said the top model was weighted as 83%. Why 83%?
That's just what the AIC model selection process, that was the weight given to that model. It was just part of the math, I guess.
And John Solovsky asks, in your opinion, how does the presence of kit fox in the Trans-Pecos compare to swift fox in the Panhandle?
I'm really not sure. I've only read a couple of the papers that have been published on the swift fox and the panhandle. But I suppose I think kit fox occupy a greater portion of the state, just as far as land mass goes, than swift fox do currently. Anyway, I think swift fox have really kind of been pushed back quite a bit.
That would be my read as well. I think swift foxes are isolated in primarily one county with just I think we had one observation in the county. I guess that would be up in is it
Dillon
Childress?
and Sherman counties or something.
Exactly. Thank you.
Yeah, Dillon, there you go.
And okay, yeah, Dallum. Yep. And so I think I think from what I have seen, kit foxes seem to be doing quite a bit better, or at least be much more widespread in the Trans-Pecos than swift foxes are up in the Panhandle.
Yeah, I agree with that.